We bow down and confess you are Lord in this place. We bow down and confess you are Lord in this place.
Well, hi everyone. Well, hang on. I guess I don't really need this on a video, do I? Oh, good. I can take this one off. You know, when COVID first started to take hold in Europe and we realized it was serious, I came across this cartoon. Now, in it, you can see religions of all types and they're freaking out in fear at this oncoming virus. And they're at the cliff's edge, and they're all pleading with the scientist who is calmly but purposefully looking into his microscope. And the religions are all screaming, please, hurry up. Now, if there was ever a cartoon that in my mind summed up the current age, this is it. Religion, it says, stands frightened and powerless before the virus. Ah, but science is the great hope. Now, if you think I'm about to say that faith is good and science is bad, then you have me so wrong. I think that is such an unhelpful belief. I nearly failed chemistry at high school, but I know enough to realize that science is a gift from God. And I literally thank the Lord that we have scientists around the world putting their God-given brains to this virus problem. But what I think this cartoon shows us is where our society puts its hope. Or more importantly, where it doesn't. People outside the walls of a church are not putting their hope in religion. And they're not finding hope in God. And yet, is the world a more hopeful place as a result? I mean, hardly. In fact, there's this pervading sense of hopelessness in the world. Now, certainly the pandemic has contributed to that, but let's be honest, it's not just the pandemic. I mean, I cannot remember a time in my life where I've seen such consistently dark headlines. There is famine, mass unemployment, racism, division, uncertainty. There are wars and rumors of wars. And before the panic hit, every day brought a grim new statistic about the environment. And let's be honest, that problem hasn't gone away. Economic inequality, it's at historic levels. Trust in government and many leaders is evaporating. And fear and anger are spilling into the streets. Suicides are up. They are disproportionately common in Europe and disproportionately common amongst our young people. In fact, suicide is now the second leading cause of death for children between the ages of 10 and 19 in the US. Children, think about that. Oh, and the rates, they've doubled in the last 15 years. The other week, I was talking to some of our younger folks that are connected to this church, and they told me about the genuine fears that their generation have about the future. For some, though, it's not even fear. It's just this sense of resignation that their generation's future is, well, frankly, doomed. I mean, it feels kind of grim, you know what I mean? The Pope was recently speaking at the ecumenical Pentecost service that was led by the Archbishop of Canterbury, and I think he summed it up really well. He said, and I quote, "Today our world is experiencing a tragic famine of hope." How much pain, he said. How much pain is all around us. How much emptiness. How much inconsolable grief. There is indeed a tragic famine of hope. But then he also said this, "Let us then become messengers of the comfort bestowed by the Spirit. Let us radiate hope." I love that. Let us radiate hope. Now, I know that some of you listening to this message will actually struggle with the fact that I'm quoting the Pope here in a Pentecost church. And I'm sorry about that. And I ask you to please look beyond that and see the truth in his words and the urgency. The world is experiencing a tragic famine of hope. And his statement raises an important question. Do we, as a people of God, do we, as Christians, radiate hope? The cartoon I showed you, frankly, would suggest that no, we don't. The world looks at religion of any type, Christianity included, and sees the same fear and hopelessness as the rest of the world sees. So again, I ask, are we as Christians radiating hope to the world? Are we listening to this right now, people who radiate hope? And what would that even look like? I think an answer to that lies in some words from the book of 1 Peter. And as I read them to you, I want you to listen to the sense of confident expectation that Peter has when he talks about hope. His hope isn't in something trivial or uncertain, as if he's talking about the potential for rain tomorrow. No, you're about to hear Peter put his hope in something substantial. There is confidence in his writing, and there's great expectation about what will come. You're about to hear somebody who is radiating hope. Are you ready? Okay, let's go. We're looking at 1 Peter, chapter 1, verses 3 onwards to 6. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who, through faith, are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer all kinds of grief. In that passage there are three words that sum up what we all want: a living hope. I mean, isn't that what the world needs? A living hope, a hope that is alive, a hope that is life-changing. And around those three words are the keys to that living hope. And I think if we can get to this, we can be people who radiate hope to the world. First, did you notice how this living hope isn't just a probabilistic wish? Peter didn't have his fingers crossed saying, I hope God does this. No, he was confident in it. And did you notice that his hope wasn't for something trivial? No, Peter had a sense of certainty and excitement for something very meaningful. Look especially at verse 4. It says, he has given us new birth into a living hope, into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you. One of the problems with hope today is that we are too short-sighted. We pin our hopes on things that we think are just around the corner. Things like that, you know, that great uni result, or that new job, that promotion, that partner we will one day meet, or that bank balance. We tell ourselves that if we get one of those things, or maybe all of them, then everything will be good. Or we put our hope in our most immediate problems being solved. So all our discussions of hope are about a vaccine being found, racism ending, a sick loved one getting better, the unemployment rates improving, that politician we hate losing, or the one we prefer winning. We think, if only that would happen, life would be good. I'd have hope again. Now, every one of those things would be brilliant. Who wouldn't want any of them? And yet, they are all about the here and now. Do you know what I mean? We're very short-sighted when it comes to hope. Instead, Peter is telling us that when it comes to hope, we have to look beyond the here and now or to anything on earth and instead look to the future we have when Christ returns and we are in heaven. He's reminding us that a living hope isn't found in anything here on earth, but in a future with God in heaven. And not only is our hope often short-sighted, but I think we also often shortchange ourselves. We put our hope in things that might sound great, but are frankly unreliable and sometimes even meaningless. For instance, we put our hopes in achieving something at work. But I want you to consider right now your great-great-grandparents. Do you know what their achievements were? Heck, do you even know what their names are? We are a vapor, okay? Or what happens if my hope is in finding a vaccine, which I'm actually confident we will, but will that stop the next pandemic coming? Will the world somehow suddenly be free of all the other problems once we have a vaccine? No. Peter urges us to think bigger and not shortchange ourselves on our hopes. He reminds us that we are promised an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, an inheritance kept in heaven for you. Those are incredible words. It's hope in a future that will never let us down. We get an even more vivid picture of this future elsewhere in the Bible. It's an incredible picture of what it's going to be like. Now let's look at Revelation 21. Then I saw a new, this is John speaking, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." Now, this could be a sermon in and of itself, but John is joining Peter in saying that the future in store for us as his children will be mind-blowing, and it'll be perfect. So don't be short-sighted by only focusing on this world, and don't shortchange yourself by putting your hope in things that are ultimately meaningless. Instead, Christian hope looks forward to an incredible inheritance that will not perish. And where does Peter's confidence come from? We see that in verse 3. It says, "God has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." Now, James explained this really well last week. We can have this confident expectation about the future in heaven because of what God has done through Jesus. Peter is saying, hey, this is not some idle pie-in-the-sky hope. Look back at the resurrection and see what God did. Jesus died for our sins, and then God raised him from the dead. If he can do that, you can have absolute hope that God will do as he promises. So Christian hope looks forward to a future inheritance, but it also looks back to the resurrection to give us confidence in that promise. You know he will do what he promises in the future because of what he has done and proven in the past. Ah, but there is more. Because then Peter says something else very interesting. He says in verse 4 and 5, "This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time." God isn't just saying, "Hey everyone, I want you to keep your eyes on heaven. I'll see you on the other side. Until then, you're on your own." No, Peter says, "You who through faith are being shielded by God's power." Our faith in Jesus shields us with God's power now. As we struggle through the tough realities of our lives here, God protects our faith, even in that difficult time between Christ's death and our ultimate resurrection. And that's really important, because the living hope that Peter is pointing us to isn't some naive optimism that, you know, everything on earth will always be easy and perfect. Far from it. Peter is writing to a persecuted church who know how badly things can go. In fact, in verse 6, he reminds them, "In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer grief in all kinds of trials." A living hope doesn't say that bad things won't happen or, hey, you're on your own. A living hope says, yeah, bad things will happen because life and humanity is imperfect. But we can look forward to a time when all will be made new and marvelous. And we will look back to the resurrection to give us confidence in that hope. And we look now to the God who protects our faith and holds us up through the current mess. That is the living hope. It's long-sighted, not short-sighted. It chooses to make the things of this world blurry and to put heaven into sharp focus. And it doesn't shortchange our hope. It doesn't put hope in things of this world that, you know, might be great but aren't permanent. Instead, it finds hope in a meaningful future that won't perish, spoil, or fade. Now, if we are honest, holding on to this type of hope isn't easy, right? I think it becomes a daily choice, and to have that long-term focus and a prayerfulness to think back often to his resurrection for reassurance and to trust our faith to God when we're struggling. In my experience, none of those things is easy, but I think they are the way to real hope. Now, shifting gears, I think there are two important questions that this discussion on hope gives rise to. First, there's an old expression that said that somebody can be so heavenly minded that they are of no earthly good. Forgive me. They can be so heavenly minded that they are of no earthly good. Is that possible? Can we become so focused on heaven that we miss out on what we have now? Well, frankly, I don't think the risk is that we'll think too much about heaven. I think the issue many of us have is not thinking about it enough. That, or we have a really uninspiring view of heaven. I don't think that we think about heaven in a way that even comes close to the majesty that was in the mind of Peter and John when they wrote about it. I also think that because we live in such comfort in the West, we don't often feel that deep need for that inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, or that time when things will be made new and he will wipe every tear from our eyes. I don't think in our comfort we really think about those things much. That is, until we come up hard against death and grief. And I think that's what's been happening lately. Suddenly in those circumstances, you know, hope becomes real. Yet hope feels like something we pull out and talk about when life gets hard, but not something that wakes us all up every morning and drives us. At least that's the case for me. But what if it became that? What if we lived with a greater sense of confidence and anticipation for heaven every day? What if it's what we thought about when we woke up and dreamt about when we went to sleep? And I think we need to become more excited about that future than anything we're excited about here on earth. I think that will reorientate our priorities and change how we engage with the world. C.S. Lewis, the famous writer and Christian of the mid-20th century, he understood this. In his classic book, Mere Christianity, he said this about hope. That's a long quote, but let me read it. A continual looking forward to the eternal world is not a form of escapism or wishful thinking, but one of the things that a Christian is meant to do. It does not mean that we are to leave the present world as it is. If you read history, you will find that the Christians who did most for the present world were those who thought most of the next. The apostles themselves, who set on foot the conversion of the Roman Empire. The great men who built up the Middle Ages. The English evangelicals who have abolished the slave trade all left their mark on heaven precisely because their minds were occupied with heaven. They all left their mark on earth precisely because their minds were occupied with heaven. It is since Christians have largely ceased to think of the other world that they have become so ineffective in this. That man was a genius. This leads me to my second, tougher question. If we recognize that the things of earth are temporary and meaningless in comparison to the things of heaven, and also that the world isn't going to be perfect until Christ returns, should we even care about what happens here on earth? I think strongly yes. Just as C.S. Lewis pointed out, we can't just have hope for heaven and not care about what is happening on earth. I think having a living hope can and should lead us to care for how things are in the world and to do something about them. I think it's an act of love for people, and I think it can be an act of witness to the hope we have. Let me quickly explain both of those, and then we'll wrap up. First, love. It's not an accident that Paul says elsewhere, now these three things remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Hope that doesn't translate into love for those around us isn't a living hope. Paul makes that point even more directly in the opening verses of 1 Colossians, where he says, to the Colossians, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, because we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love you have for all God's people, the faith and love that spring from the hope stored up for you in heaven. I mean, that is direct. Our hope in heaven can't lead us to switch off from the needs that exist around us here on earth. In fact, it must motivate it. From hope must spring love. Second, I think us working to make things better here on earth can bear witness to the hope we have. Now, let me explain what I mean by that with an analogy. I am a cinephile. I know that sounds like something I should repent of, but it basically means I really love movies. You only have to talk to me for about 30 minutes before you realize that. In fact, one of the things that I am looking forward to the most after this pandemic is over is going to a cinema. Seriously. That's when I know this thing will be behind us. And I usually have a pretty good idea of what movies are coming up because I watch movie trailers. IMDb, Apple Trailers, you name it, I'm there. Movie trailers are one of the ways I decide if I want to see a film. Importantly, a good movie trailer doesn't replace the movie. I don't say, wow, I've seen the trailer, I never need to go to the film. But what a good trailer does is it makes me want to go there. As Christians, our lives can be like movie trailers for the future that God offers every one of his children in heaven. We have an opportunity to give people a taste of what is to come, a taste of what Jesus has promised he will do if we are only going to follow him. Now, us acting out of hope should make the world say, I want to go there. I want to be part of that movie. A living hope lives out your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I truly and increasingly believe that this call to love and bear witness to God's promises means that we as Christians need to take an active role in areas of society where people are losing hope. We can't just have hope for heaven and not care about what is happening on earth. And in fact, the younger generation especially, they will look at any faith and hope that is not characterized by acts of love and see it as empty. Finally, I think we need to live out our hope with a sense of joy and optimism. And notice I said optimism, not hope. We don't go into the world putting our hope on a vaccine being found, or our hope in the climate improving, or putting our hope in poverty ending, or any of these great things. But as an act of love and witness, we will work towards those things with joy, even optimism. Optimism about what God can do here on earth. Let me give you a couple of very quick examples. I'm actually genuinely optimistic that scientists will find a vaccine or a treatment for this virus so fewer people will die. I really am. And won't that be amazing? But my hope will not be in the vaccine. My hope will be in a God that conquered death and has promised an eternity where there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain. And until then, I'll show my love to others by wearing masks, washing my hands, and practicing social distancing. They're acts of love. I'm also optimistic when I look at the movements that are happening around the world. I'm optimistic that racism and hatred, because of the color of somebody's skin, will go down. And I'll examine and repent of my own biases and give people a foretaste of heaven by standing against racism myself. Why? Because my hope is in a God who says that we are all one in Christ Jesus, and who promises a heaven where a vast multitude from every nation, tribe, people, and language will stand before him together. There's no racism in heaven, so I work towards no racism here. I'm also optimistic about the work that people are doing in the world to care for this planet. I'm cautiously optimistic, but my hope may not be in the environment, but my hope is in the God who has promised that he is making all things new and who promises a new heaven and a new earth when this is all over. In the meantime, I'll see my own actions to care for the planet as a way to bring glimpses of that future and as an act of love for the generations that follow. Hope manifests itself in love, and love rolls up its sleeves and gets dirty. And I'll be optimistic about the changes we see when we as a church go into the world working towards improving it. But I also know that things won't always go the way we want it to. We live in a broken world. There will be other pandemics. There will continue to be people who promote hate and division and inequality. The planet will still groan. The poor will still be mistreated. But not forever. And it's in that forever that we have to put our hope. Because one day, God will make everything perfect. Not now, not in this world as we know it, but he will. Because our hope is a confident expectation that one day he'll overcome perfectly everything. That is living hope.
Bye.